It feels like the seat is getting hotter for Matt Eberflus, even at 4-3, but Bears fans are ready to have the pitchforks and torches out. Is that too soon? Too much of an overreaction? And what's going to be best for Caleb Williams in this process? A lot to talk about with the present and future of the Chicago Bears head coach on today's Locked On Bears podcast.
You are Locked On Bears, your daily Chicago Bears podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
This is Locked On Bears, and I'm your host, Lorin Cox. I'm here to bring you your daily in-depth Chicago Bears news and analysis. You can follow me on Twitter at CoxSports1, and you can follow the podcast at Locked On Bears on all your favorite social media platforms, including the Locked On Bears YouTube channel, where you can keep up with our video podcasts as well. Thanks for making Locked On Bears your first listen today. We're part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. Today's episode is brought to you by Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use our promo code LOCKEDONNFL for $20 off your first purchase. On the show today, we're going to talk about the job security of Matt Eberflus, and we're going to be joined by Joe George, the host of the Locked On Bears Postcast and all of the Locked On Chicago Sports Postcasts on the Locked On Chicago Sports YouTube channel. Joe, thanks so much for joining us. And I should say, welcome to the Locked On Podcast Network. You've got your Bears stuff all ready to go here, so there's no question how you're coming into this. But how's the experience been so far, and how are you taking in this season at this point?
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun. So we're doing a postcast on the Locked On Sports Chicago YouTube channel. Audio's available here for Locked On Bears podcast, which is really cool as well to kind of have that built-in audience for the game reaction. But we're doing them for Bears, Notre Dame football, the Bulls, which has been a lot of fun so far. Actually, like, surprisingly been fun for the Bulls. And we'll do Cubs eventually as well. But it's been a lot of fun. And this Bears season's been something, man. It's been a wild season already, just a couple games in.
Yeah, the Commanders game, not necessarily like as fun. I mean, it's fun in its own way, right? I mean, it's sometimes it's fun to be angry and frustrated, but certainly not a fun way for that game to go. But I'm sure there's going to be a better post games to come here. But that's always going to be on the Locked On Chicago Sports YouTube channel if you want to catch that live. Again, the audio will be in the feed here. But I want to bring you on to talk about Matt Eberflus here, because this is a weird situation where, you know, over the course of the offseason, at one point, Matt Eberflus was one of the betting favorites for Coach of the Year and also one of the betting favorites for first coach to be fired. Like, he always exists in this enigmatic space where he's either going to take this team and be great or take this team and be fired. And it's weird to be having the job security conversation after a 4-3 start. But I don't know. How real do you think the pressure is on Matt Eberflus right now, and how much do you think it's just – everyone needs to blame somebody after a really frustrating Washington game, and okay, a couple weeks from now, maybe we won't be having the same conversation.
Yeah, I think for me, man, it goes back to just like part of it's his whole career. He's 3-17 on the road as a head coach for the Chicago Bears. That's just not good enough. And I know Justin Fields and, you know, Bajent and, you know, now Caleb Williams have been his quarterback. So he's had a lot of either, you know, bad quarterback play or young quarterback play. But to be that bad on the road, I think it says a lot about, you know, who you are as a coach. And honestly, like, when the game finished, and like, obviously we're all angry in the moment to see the game end that way against Washington. My first immediate reaction was not he's on the hot seat again. It was like, oh, this is a really bad loss. This might cost them to miss the playoffs, especially within how good the NFC North is. But honestly, the more that like Monday started to kind of roll through and everyone starts doing their radio interviews in Chicago, my tone kind of changed a little bit to hear Matt Eberflus be questioned very, you know, poignantly and, you know, by David Kaplan at ESPN 1000 about not calling timeouts and really pushing back on it. But then you've got DJ Moore, Jalen Johnson, Kevin Byard, like, they're all publicly calling out their coach in interviews about not calling timeouts, about not running press coverage. And it's like, that seems like a bad vibe for your players to be feel that comfortable calling out your coach. And I know, you know, DJ was, you know, they asked him, I think on Wednesday about, you know, what did Matt Eberflus think? And he said, we want to keep it in house now. But they had the right to call him out because it was bad coaching. It was bad game time decision, management decisions. So I didn't think immediately after the game, but now I'm at the point where, like, if this season doesn't go, you know, back to, you know, making the playoffs at this point after the way they've started, I could definitely see a path to where he's not the head coach of this team. Because when you look at their schedule, like, you know, it's so weird this year. All those games at the end of the season and against the division, if they go 2-4 against their divisional opponents, I think it's going to be really tough for him to survive. It's just the Washington game kind of set things back a little bit for him.
Yeah, I agree. But it's in this weird space where, you know, the Washington game really comes down to two plays, right? The whole reason we're mad at Matt Eberflus is the play before the Hail Mary and then the Hail Mary. And if those plays go, like, two plays versus the previous 60 in the game feels a little bit, I think in a vacuum, it feels overreaction-y to say, hey, the defense was great for the vast majority of the game. They messed up two plays and all of a sudden there's turmoil and locker room issues and stuff. And yet at the same time, it feels like it's representative or of a longer term issue here, right? That it's not the Washington, it's not just the Washington game. It's the Washington game after, you know, the Denver game last season where they blew a big halftime lead and a number of games, the first Lions game, right? Where you're leading late and you can't hold on. And it feels like there's this disconnect between, you know, the moments where the head coaching decisions actually affect wins and losses, leading you in the negative direction. So I find myself torn. I'm always like, well, guys, like it's one loss to Washington. You're still 4-3. They can still make the playoffs. Like, we should relax. And also, like, well, how many times does this have to keep happening before we look around and say this is a real problem and not just growing pains or a young team trying to figure things out?
Yeah, I think part of it too for me is he's got to take some of the blame. Maybe it's Ryan Poles. Like, obviously we're not there with who's hiring Shane Waldron, but for him to, you know, plus the Doug Kramer play, like that play is unforgivable. When you lose a football game to hand it to an offensive lineman, it's crazy, and to watch him fumble it. But just how inept the offense looked and unprepared they were in this game coming off a bye week, it's really startling. I know he doesn't coach the offense, but whoever hired Shane Waldron like has to take some fall for that too. And you assume it's the head coach. I mean, maybe it was Ryan Poles and he'll fall on the sword for, you know, that decision of bringing in Waldron and just how clunky it's been. But I think it's big picture. It's not just the Washington game. And then as Bears fans, we all know it's a fear of what's to come. It's, you know, what's going to look like against Green Bay. And especially like if it's Malik Willis is the quarterback the first time you play him and you lose that game, what's it look like, you know, versus Minnesota and Detroit, who's putting up like 200 points in the last 4 weeks. It feels like it's a tipping point for the season of what bad things could happen. I think that's why people are, you know, wanting this or wanting to talk about Matt Eberflus being on the hot seat. And Albert Breer, you know, coming out on 1000 in Chicago and saying that, you know, Ben Johnson wanted the Bears job doesn't help Matt Eberflus with Bears fans for sure.
I think there's a lot of speculation about why the timing that came out this week of all weeks, when Albert Breer has known the Ben Johnson thing since probably January, when Ben Johnson was interested, you know, since the news would have been, you know, new at that time, but it just happens to come out this week during an interview when he brings it up. You just kind of wonder, especially because Breer is definitely well-connected in Hallis Hall and has a good chummy relationships with Poles and even Eberflus as well. But I'm glad you talked about like how it's more about the future, right? Like, it's not so much like everything is so bad right now that you have to fire Matt Eberflus, but it's like, based on what we've seen for 2.5 seasons, we look ahead to what's still to come over the rest of this season and say, well, it's got to be bad then, and then he's going to be fired, you know, if it goes poorly. But that is an assumption. We don't know that for sure. So I want to look ahead here at, okay, over the course of the rest of the season, what would it take for Matt Eberflus to get fired, and what would it take, like, what does he have to do to make sure he does save his job and come back next season? We'll look ahead at the rest of the schedule and the stakes for Matt Eberflus next on Locked On Bears. The Locked On Bears podcast is brought to you by our friends at Game Time, the best way to get tickets for all of your favorite live events. I have the Game Time app on my phone and I use it all the time, whether I'm getting tickets to a Bears game or I use it to go to concerts, comedy shows, theater events, you name it, they've got all your ticket needs at Game Time. What I like about Game Time is you can see your view from your seat in the app before you buy the tickets, so you know exactly what you're going to get with your ticket purchase. And you can also turn on all-in pricing, so you know exactly how much you're going to pay for your tickets, and there won't be any of those added fees at the end of the checkout process that make the tickets cost way more than you thought they would. So take the guesswork out of buying tickets with Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use our promo code LOCKEDON, NFL, for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account and redeem that code LOCKEDON, NFL, for $20 off. Download Game Time today. What time is it? Game Time. The Locked On Bears podcast is also brought to you by 5-Hour Energy, and they know that being a passionate football fan isn't just a hobby, it's a way of life. And it takes a lot of energy to power through all-day tailgates, touchdown celebrations, or maybe agonizing Hail Mary plays. And I think sometimes you need a little bit of that energy, whether you're the fan in the stands pointing at Tyreek Stevenson to get back on coverage on the Hail Mary, or you're the fan on the couch pointing at Tyreek Stevenson to get back on Hail Mary coverage. 5-Hour Energy can give you that boost to make sure that you are more dialed into this game than maybe some of the Chicago Bears players in critical moments. 5-Hour Energy knows that no matter what team you root for, being a fan requires heart, soul, and a whole lot of energy. So whether you're prepping for a big tailgate or ironing your jersey, your game day to-do list is a mile long. That's why the limited edition Stand the Fan 5-Hour Energy Shot is here to help keep you fueled throughout the season. What's your fan fuel this week? Whatever it is, do it with a 5-Hour Energy and the Stand the Fan 5-Hour Energy Shot. Available on 5hourenergy.com, shipped nationwide. All right, Lorin Cox, Locked On Bears, here with Joe George from the Locked On Chicago Sports Postcasts here in the Locked On Podcast Network. You can follow him on Twitter at JoeGeorge92. He's also the co-host of Gallant and George on ESPN 97.5 in Houston as well. He's a true professional here, and we're happy to have him bringing you live post-game breakdowns after every Chicago Bears game. Go check it out on the Locked On Chicago Sports YouTube channel, and you'll hear the audio in the Locked On Bears podcast feed. Joe, as we look ahead here, I mean, you talked about the playoffs, you talk about the division record. What do you think the minimum looks like here for Matt Eberflus? I mean, is it playoffs, you keep your job, miss the playoffs, you're fired? Or, you know, if you win some division games but miss the playoffs, does that make a difference? Or vice versa, you go 2-4 in the division, but you win all the other games and sneak in the playoffs, just losing the division. Like, I don't know, what do you sort of see as the pivotal aspects here that the Bears should be evaluating, even if maybe they make a different decision than we think?
Yeah, I think it really just comes down to the playoffs will help. Well, I mean, if he makes the playoffs, it's almost impossible to fire a coach, right? Like, we've seen it happen. I know the Tennessee Titans did it like 2 or 3 years ago, I think it was. Or maybe it was before that even. Maybe it was before Vrabel. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so it's like you make the playoffs, you're probably safe at this point if you're Matt Eberflus. I don't know. So it's like, if you don't like Matt Eberflus, I guess you're almost like rooting against the Bears in a way for that to happen. But I would imagine making the playoffs keeps his job. But, you know, it's funny, even though he's a defensive coach, I just feel like it matters the most with Caleb Williams, that what happened in this game doesn't happen again. You know, he's had two really, really bad games this season versus Washington and Houston. He doesn't have to be what he was the two games before the bye. I think that's a crazy expectation for him to be that excellent all the time. But if Caleb Williams continues to develop in a really positive way and you're competitive the rest of the season and you go, you know, and you don't make the playoffs, I think that's okay. But basically, I just need to be convinced that they're not going to screw up Caleb Williams. I don't necessarily know what that looks like, but as long as at the end of the season I'm convinced that this franchise is going to do the right thing by Caleb Williams, that will help Matt Eberflus keep his job for sure.
I'm with you that Caleb Williams' development should be the most important thing and is the priority in my mind over the playoffs. You know, and the win-loss record matters less than is your quarterback set up to be the long-term future. But I do wonder, like, if the Bears will see that as tied to Matt Eberflus' job security or not, right? Like, that feels like the Shane Waldron question a little bit more than the Matt Eberflus question, because I mean, yes, Eberflus is involved, but it feels to me more like, okay, is your offensive coordinator doing what needs to be done to develop this quarterback? And then kind of along with that, I guess, is if Caleb is being developed properly, then you might win enough games to make the playoffs. And then that comes back to Matt Eberflus. But I don't know. Do you feel like Shane Waldron's seat should be just as hot then as Matt Eberflus's? But then, you know, okay, say you want to fire Shane Waldron at the end of the year. Like, does Matt Eberflus get to pick a third offensive coordinator? How tied are they in this? And what kind of patience and leash should Shane Waldron get, you know, he's what, seven games into being the Bears offensive coordinator. I mean, even Luke Getsy got 2 years to figure it out.
Yeah, I think they have to be directly tied. It would be really uncomfortable to see them fire Shane Waldron after 1 year and then keep Matt Eberflus, unless there's something like, if there's a head coach that gets fired this year that is an excellent offensive mind that's going to struggle to find a job, which we just don't rarely see. Normally, it's the other side of the ball, right? It's Brian Flores. Brian Flores didn't get a job right away, but he was immediately a hot candidate. Matt Eberflus will be the number one defensive coordinator candidate in the NFL if he gets fired this offseason. I mean, people will be running to him to pair him with a young OC in the NFL. I mean, I wish we'd lived in a world where, like, he could get demoted to defensive coordinator and they could bring in Ben Johnson as the head coach and like everything would be sunshine and rainbows and they could make it work that way. But I would assume they're directly tied together. If they're not, Shane Waldron, his seat is hotter to me. From the very beginning, that report that was out there that they weren't scripting plays at the beginning of the season just like blew my mind. The play calling in general has been terrible. I think we're never going to forget the, you know, fourth and five or the first and, you know, five and in against Indianapolis, that disaster. The Doug Kramer play will live on for a while. I think back to the Houston game too, where there's that video of him shaking as he's calling plays. And I'm just like, this guy cannot be the OC for the Chicago Bears. So I for me personally, he's on the way hotter seat than Matt Eberflus. But for Matt, and you know, it's a lot of it will probably come down to even if they don't make the playoffs, I think that road record will matter a lot because it will just tell you about like how well your team is prepared. If he goes 2-4 against the division, but all four of the, like three of those losses are on the road, that's going to put you in a tough spot to keep him around. So I do think they're tied together, but there's a possibility like it splits. What do you think? You think they're tied together?
I do think they have to be. I don't think they give Matt Eberflus a second, another OC choice, a second new OC. So I guess a third OC in that regard. But I do like the point you made there. Like, it's not a good sign when the memorable plays from your offensive coordinator this year, like the ones that stick in your brain, are the bad ones, right? We remember the speed option at the goal line. Remember the Doug Kramer. Also, they're all plays at the goal line. It feels like are the ones
which is worse. It's the worst.
Yeah, but you know, at the same time, I do think I don't know if we're always, and I don't mean you in the we here, but just the royal we. I don't know if we're always fair to the offensive coordinator. Like when Caleb Williams makes a great throw on a play, we give the quarterback all the credit there, and certainly the quarterback had to make a great throw, but the offensive coordinator had to call the play. Like you know, like the throw to DJ Moore against the Commanders in the corner there when Caleb got hit by the free blitzer. Like, yeah, I mean, you could say the protection needed to be different, but like Shane Waldron called a play where a receiver would be there for Caleb to throw the ball to him. And like DeAndre Swift's big run, like, okay, it wasn't a genius play call, but he did stick with the running game enough that eventually Swift could wear them down and break one open. Like, it feels like there's some redeeming qualities of offensive coordinating there, even if there's a lot of bad too. It doesn't feel like is Shane Waldron the worst OC in the NFL right now? I don't think so, but probably in the bottom half. But so I don't know like where the threshold then. I guess it comes down to like, how is Caleb Williams' development at the end of the year? Like, full circle here, back to what we talked about earlier.
Yeah, and I don't know how you feel, because I'm very pro. Like, I think about like what's happened in the NBA about players having control over their team and their coaches. And like, I get why LeBron has it, but like when James Harden was having it in Houston, like, why is he demanding all these superstars be traded? So I don't know how I feel. I don't love it. But if they go in to meet with Caleb Williams and they're like, hey, what do you think? And he says, this isn't going to work for me. I think we need to find a different offensive coordinator. I would be okay with him listening to that, because I do think he would know best, honestly, of like what is working and what's not. Like, you have to rely on DJ Moore, Keenan Allen in his exit interview, who's, you know, he's probably not going to be a Bear next year. So he should give you an honest answer about what's going on here in Chicago. But so I think you have to take that into effect. But you're right. Like what happened in, you know, in London against Jacksonville in the two games before, you can't ignore that for Shane Waldron. And we are unfair to offensive coordinators. The quarterback gets all the praise Caleb gets all the praise for what they did with Cole Kmet and DeAndre Swift. But a lot of that credit has to go to Shane Waldron. I'll be honest, for me, I go back to the interview that Jackson Smith and Jigba did at Radio Row when they asked him about Shane Waldron, and he just kind of stood there because he didn't know. He wanted to be politically correct, and it was one of those things where you could tell it was like, if you have nothing nice to say, don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all. And I was just like, that was like, didn't like the vibes of that. So we'll see. I'm not a Waldron guy. I'm kind of pro-change, which leads me to, because I do think they're tied together, being more pro-Eberflus change for sure.
Yeah, that's that was the first red flag, Jackson Smith and Jigba. At the time, yeah,
it's a big one.
It was like, but, you know, cautiously proceed forward there. Like, at the end of the day, it is about what's best for Caleb Williams. And I want to hammer down on that point a little bit, and this idea of, like, the whole reason they kept Matt Eberflus was to try and, you know, stick with continuity, right? That was sort of the theme. They want to bring stuff back and kind of run it back and then upgrade the quarterback spot. And so they're going to value continuity to some degree for Caleb. And so there's this question, there's a tension here between, like, okay, keeping the same staff around Caleb, even if they have flaws, just to not have to have so much change and turmoil in the second year of a quarterback that the Bears have been doing over and over again, versus firing the staff to make sure you get the right guy. And I want to get into some of the mechanics of that next on Locked On Bears. This episode of Locked On Bears is brought to you by our friends at FanDuel Sportsbook, America's number one sportsbook. Get ready to tackle all of the NFL action on FanDuel, because right now new customers can bet $5 and get $150 in bonus bets if your bet wins. The FanDuel Sportsbook app gives you everything you need to place live bets on the NFL as well. So if you get a hunch in the middle of this Bears-Cardinals game, for example, you can check out the latest stats, view live play-by-play, and so much more on the same page where you place your bets. So right now the spread in Bears-Cardinals is Bears are underdogs by 1.5 points on the road. The money line actually has Bears plus 102. It's plus money if you want to bet the Bears against just straight up. And then the over-under set at 44.5 points. So if you place that $5 bet now, or even during the game, if you hit that bet, they're going to give you an extra $150 in bonus bets. Just visit FanDuel.com to join today. Never waste a hunch and make every moment more with FanDuel, an official sportsbook partner of the NFL. All right, Lorin Cox and Joe George continuing today's episode of Locked On Bears. Again, you can check out George on the Locked On Chicago Sports Postcast, live on the Locked On Chicago Sports YouTube channel, and the audio comes in the Locked On Bears feed, not just for Bears games, but Bulls, Notre Dame football, and, you know, as we get back to the baseball season and hockey season and stuff, more on the way from Joe. But Joe, I want to get into the dynamic here, because I think it's easy to say, okay, you got to get the right head coach for Caleb Williams, so as soon as you know Matt Eberflus is not the guy, you fire him, you move it on, you go get Ben Johnson, you go get Bobby Slowick from Houston, you go get, you know, whatever young offensive mind you think is the right guy for your team. And then, okay, now we're set because Caleb's got the right guy. And the Bears have been pretty clear about preaching continuity and wanting to keep the band together, especially because of Matt Eberflus' ability on defense. And that can also support a quarterback through his development. If you know that side of the ball is going to be good, then all you got to do is get your offensive coordinator pick right, and you know, you can keep putting different guys there. And I kind of see some of both here, because just because you fire Matt Eberflus and Shane Waldron and you go out and get the, you know, Ben Johnson or whatever, like, doesn't mean that that head coach is necessarily going to be a better head coach. I mean, you hope that they would be. You hire them with the thought that they would be, but, you know, we thought Matt Nagy was going to come in and do for Mitch Trubisky what he did for Patrick, well, what he did and Andy Reid did really for Patrick Mahomes in Kansas City, right? But, like, that was why they fired John Fox and went and got Matt Nagy, because it was like, okay, go get the young offensive mind for the quarterback. But it turned out not a great head coach, maybe a decent offensive coordinator, not a great head coach. And so it's sort of the devil you know with Eberflus and Waldron versus the devil you don't know with some other coach. And there's a risk there. Like, it could be better with a new coach, but it also could be worse, or just another or the same. And then you have to change over coaches again a couple of times. I don't know. Where do you sort of fall on that spectrum?
Yeah, I definitely don't. I mean, going into the season, I would have been pro. I wanted the change to happen last year. I just thought, like, it's the most logical thing to do is to start fresh with a new quarterback, a new, you know, head coach. I kind of would have, I really like polls. So I would, so in this instance, I would have said not a new GM. But I just think starting fresh just makes more sense, because You don't have to ever ask these questions. We would never be asking this question right now if Ben Johnson was the coach and they were doing the exact same thing. We would just say it's growing pain, they're learning. We'd be taking the positive of everything, but it's the negative of the Eberflus Fields era that is just spilling over. So I would have rather that happened. I'm with you that I would rather not have to do what they did to Trubisky and to Fields with bringing in a new, you got a coach, they draft the quarterback, that coach gets fired. Immediately, questions are, do you actually like this quarterback? I think with Caleb, it'll be a little bit different if that happens than it was with Fields and with Mitch. But, you know, it's better for the Bears, honestly, if this group works out. It is better for Caleb Williams if, you know, Shane Waldron and Matt Eberflus, you know, keep it going and keep this thing on a positive trajectory. And Washington was just a little blip in what happened. So hopefully it continues in a positive way and they can keep him. Because that's what's best for Caleb, most likely.
Yeah, I want to dig in a little bit on this because it's kind of the theme here, right? It's can Caleb stay on the positive trajectory? You know, that can keep Matt Eberflus's job. That can keep Shane Waldron's job. And we talked a little bigger picture about, okay, what does the team have to do? Well, it really depends on what Caleb has to do. So like, what does that look like? Okay, so it's not so much about do they win 10 games and make the playoffs. It's about does Caleb look like he's on the right track? But like, you know, like was this Washington game still Caleb on the right track because he was so good in the fourth quarter? Like obviously he was bad for the first three quarters, but like, oh, in the final 10 minutes, I think he was like 6 of 8 for 95 yards, just dialed it in. So like, it didn't feel to me like the Caleb Williams development, you know, got off the rails and he had some horrible game that now we're having serious questions. So like, yes, I mean, it was going up and then it dropped down a little bit, but we're still in the positive trajectory. So, you know, what is the right trajectory for Caleb Williams look like over the course of the rest of the year?
I think for me now it's, what is it? The Bears, I have like, it's like less than like 2 points the first quarter, like on average this season.
Yes.
Like I think it kind of starts there. Because he finished great. I'm with you. Like, Tyreek Stevenson, it was like a blessing for Caleb Williams that no one was talking about Caleb Williams versus Jaden Daniels the next couple days because we were all just so focused on the disaster at the end of the game. But for me, it starts at the beginning of the game, just seeing the offense just come out more, you know, more fluid and him looking more calm and relaxed than he did in this last one. Obviously, like, returning home, maybe that's a huge factor, but they've been pretty bad the entire season. You know, even before the bye with like their opening possessions and what they're doing. So it kind of starts there for me. It's just that's something tangible that I think we can actually see change for the Bears offense and for Caleb Williams is to come out of the game, be confident, be effective, and move the ball down the field and score. Like that's a huge sign of improvement because if he does what he does the last three games, then Shane Waldron probably deserves to keep his job. Like I don't really think there's much question about it because of how well Caleb Williams has played. So I think you're right. I think it's just continuing what he's doing. And then the big markers besides that will be Minnesota, Detroit, Green Bay, those six games. And you play San Francisco and Seattle. Like your schedule sucks at the end of the season. You play, I mean, Mike McDonald was one of the best DCs for the Ravens last year. So like, you know, Seattle, I think a lot of people have kind of in their mind put that as like a W in the column for the Bears. And it's not. I think that's the real test is like, what does he do against Brian Flores twice? What does he do against Dan Campbell twice? Like, what does he do against the Packers twice? Like that's like the real question. But if this continues, then I think they're on a path to keeping everyone at this point in the season.
Yeah. I think it's not only the fact that those are divisional games, but also that those will be some of the best defenses Caleb Williams faces all year. Right. And how he handles the real top-notch competition will tell us a lot about his progress and his trajectory. Because, like, I was thinking back over the first seven games of the season, like, what's really the best defense the Bears have played? Is it the Texans? I mean, they rank, I think, 15th in points right now, but they've had some ups and downs. The Titans' defense felt really good in week one, but was that just a bad Bears offense? But, like, Colts' defense wasn't very good. The Rams' defense wasn't very good. The Panthers' defense wasn't very good. The Jaguars' defense wasn't very good. So it's like Commanders, Texans, or Titans? It doesn't feel like he's faced what we would call a really good defense yet. And so how he does, I think the Vikings are in that category of like a team that is going to get in your face and cause a lot of trouble. They're a top 10 defense in the NFL. I think the Lions are up there in the top 10 similarly, and we'll see where the 49ers are by that stage of the season. But like, to me, like those are going to be the real test moments. Like the Commanders game was supposed to be like a small measuring stick test, and he didn't do great in that test until the very end of the fourth quarter there. So it's sort of the, I don't know. Do you feel some of that tension of like how much has he really been tested yet?
100%. And even against the Commanders and the Texans, it's like, what's he supposed to do? Like he got hit like 15 times, 20 times. It felt like, including all the sacks against the Texans. What's he supposed to do? Like he's under fire. So, and versus the Commanders, it was a disaster. The offensive line, you can't really see development when he's under fire and just, you know, constantly being hit by the defense. Like you kind of need a miracle for your offensive line to get healthy at this point against like Minnesota, and then see how does it look. Cause it's really hard to, ding Caleb Williams for the Texans game when he couldn't breathe. And for this game, for, you know, three quarters where he couldn't breathe, it's just like, what are we supposed to take away from that when your quarterback is getting slaughtered on a daily basis, it feels like.
Yeah, and it doesn't feel like it's going to get easier right away with the injury report this week with, you know, Braxton Jones missing practice, Karan Amagaji missing practice, Tevin Jenkins limited at practice, Ryan Bates limited at practice. At least Larry Borum looks like he's coming back. So whatever happens with this Bears offensive line on Sunday, you can be sure that Joe George is going to be there in the Locked On Chicago Sports postcast after the game live on YouTube to break down hopefully a Chicago Bears win, but even another Chicago Bears loss. He'll be there to either meet your excitement or meet your rage with open arms. So George, Joe, really appreciate you joining us today. And well, we'll hear from you on Sunday and throughout the rest of the season.
Appreciate it, man. Thank you. Yeah, I'm hoping to get some wins under these games for these postcasts. They're a little more enjoyable, I've learned so far when the team wins versus when they lose.
Well, we'll hope to give you something to be excited about. And of course, you can follow him on Twitter at JoeGeorge92 as well. Go check him out. And of course, keep making Locked On Bears your first listen of the day. Make a Locked On Chicago Sports postcast your first listen on Sundays after the game. He'll be live before any kind of Locked On Bears podcast comes out the following day. So keep tuning in, keep pumping that up and getting more Chicago sports talk in your feeds here. All part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. Then Locked On Bears will be back for you on Monday and through the week, and we'll keep going on our regular cycle here. And we'll just make sure that every single day, whether it's me or Joe, that you're going to get another opportunity to bear down.